Hello, and thank you for joining us today for our webinar on North Korean threat actors. My name is Dick O'Brien, and I'm the research editor here at Symantec. I'm going to start with an overview of what we know about North Korean sponsored actors. And then I'm going to hand it over to my colleague, Sylvester Segura, who's a threat intelligence analyst. He's in our office in San Francisco today. That's why he's wearing his mask. And he's going to do a deep dive on the Stonefly group, who have been responsible for a lot of recent high-level espionage activity that originates from North Korea. And then finally, we're going to talk to Javier Santoyo, who is a technical director for Symantec Endpoint Solutions. And he's going to talk you through a little bit how to best leverage our products in order to protect yourself against these threats. So before I get going, we've just got a little bit of housekeeping to get through. A lot of you may have used BrightTalk before, but if you haven't used it, there's a few things to know. You can ask questions. So if you hit the question mark button or the ask a question button, you can type it in there and we'll try and answer as many of them as possible at the end of the presentation. You can also download slides or any other information we've uploaded relating to the webinar by hitting the attachments links. And also, please do give us a rating at the end of the presentation. And then finally, if you have to leave early or if you want to listen back, you can use the same link you used to join today's webinar to listen to a recording. Now, I'll just start talking about North Korean actors. In our view, when we're talking about advanced persistent threat actors, which are essentially state-sponsored attackers, one of the things we usually stress to customers is that to never assume that they're not going to be a target for these kinds of attacks. There is a small tendency to assume that it's governments or military organizations that are usually attacked, but businesses are frequent targets. That could be for the intellectual property they hold. It could be because they represent a stepping stone on a supply chain attack, or it could be somebody like a telco or an airline because the attackers want to spy on their customers. Anyway, this advice is particularly relevant to North Korean actors because along with good old-fashioned espionage, their attacks are motivated by several other factors as well. So first of all, we have what you could classify as sabotage attacks. That could include DDoS attacks, or it could involve disk wiping attacks. And they're essentially designed to disrupt or embarrass the target of both of them. Then the third main motivation we've seen are financial. The most famous example of this was probably the least successful, and that was the WannaCry ransomware attacks, but there have been many more, far more successful operations. Now, when they started, we wondered whether this was going to be a temporary flirtation, I guess, on the part of North Korean actors. But I think at this stage, it's fair to say that they've been going on for so long that they're now a permanent feature of North Korean sponsored activity. So the long and the short of it is that given the huge range of motivations that we've seen driving their attacks, we think any large organization should consider itself a potential target. Now, let's take a look at these attacks in more detail. I'm going to leave aside espionage for the moment because Sylvester is going to be talking a lot about that when he talks about recent North Korean espionage. And I'll just mention the disruptive attacks. I think the first example we saw was some DDoS attacks, which occurred in July 2009 that were linked to the Stonefly group, a group we're going to be hearing an awful lot more about later. And they were mounted against a number of South Korean and US government and financial websites. So the targets, they were all fairly obvious. They're the two countries which North Korea considers its chief enemies. And it's an early example of the kind of aggression that we've made reference to in the title of today's presentation. Attacks, they can often be quite noisy, and they can be done as much for the publicity they generate as the disruption that they cause. And then in 2014, there was the Sony Pictures attack, which was the one that really got the world's attention. And that was, in all likelihood, a retaliation for Sony's involvement in a comedy movie set in North Korea, featuring a plotline about an assassination attempt against its leader, Kim Jong-un. And during the attack, information was stolen from the company. It was leaked to, computers were wiped, and the main goal just seemed to be to trash the place. A group calling itself Guardians of the Peace claimed responsibility for the attack, but a subsequent FBI investigation pinned it on North Korea, I think, and that was a conclusion that didn't really surprise anybody. The financially motivated attacks are probably a much more significant development. They seem to have started around 2015 with a series of attacks against banks, which culminated in the $81 million heist against the Bangladesh Central Bank. These attacks are often referred to as the SWIFT attacks because they involved the manipulation of the SWIFT payments messaging system. Now, that wasn't because of any compromise of SWIFT itself or any vulnerability in its software. Rather, they just developed malware themselves that would falsify SWIFT payment messages and then cover up the evidence of fraudulent transactions. Interestingly enough, they probably would have stolen more from the Bangladesh bank, but they were interrupted because poor spelling on one payment instruction raised suspicions. So while the Bangladesh bank strike was the biggest, there were several other attacks against banks in Asia and South America. And while these attacks were quite successful, the next venture into cybercrime was less so. I probably don't need to spend too much time talking about WannaCry because it's been so well documented. It came at a time when old-fashioned, indiscriminate kind of ransomware attacks were very much in vogue. But it was pretty clever in the way they paired it with the Eternal Blue exploit to create something that was so rapidly self-propagating. But this innovation was hampered by poor execution. Number one, they made the kill switch pretty easy to find. And number two, the ransom payment mechanism itself was botched. There was no unique Bitcoin address for each victim, meaning that if you pay the ransom, the attackers had no way of matching that payment to a particular victim. So it was kind of pointless to pay the ransom, and word got out about that fairly quickly. So that was a major blunder, but they weren't really undeterred. In 2018, we uncovered a string of attacks on ATM networks, mainly in Africa and Asia. And these involved breaching the targeted bank's network in order to gain access to the switch application server that handled ATM transactions. They would then put a Trojan, which we called Fast Cash, onto the server. And Fast Cash was an AIX executable, which is injected into a running legit process on the switch application server. And it contained logic that allowed it to create fraudulent ISO 8583 messages. And that's the international standard for financial transaction messages. So it read all of the incoming network traffic, monitoring for incoming ISO 8583 request messages. And then it would read the account number on all messages. And if it found any that contained an account number that was being used by the attackers, the Trojan would then transmit a fake response message approving a withdrawal request. And the upshot of it was is that it allowed the attackers to essentially empty any ATMs they targeted of cash. Financially motivated attacks are continuing right up to the present day. There was, for example, an FBI alert earlier on this year on North Korean activity, which mentioned attacks on cryptocurrency exchanges and related entities. And then just the other week, our peers at Kaspersky linked a new family of targeted ransomware called VHD to North Korea. Targeted ransomware is very much the cybercrime attack de jure, as you all know from the Garmin attack. And there's a lot of new actors entering this space. And I think it goes to show that the attackers linked to the North Korean regime are pretty motivated, so much so that they're going to put their hand to anything that's in vogue at a particular time and see if it works for them. So why are they undertaking financial attacks? And why do we think that they're here to stay? In short, we believe these attacks are primarily motivated by a need to generate more foreign currency for the ruling regime. And as long as there is a need for that, these kind of attacks are going to continue. So moving on to the next slide. After discussing the kinds of attacks we've seen, I want to talk a little bit about the attackers themselves. This is kind of a tricky subject when it comes to North Korea, because little or no information seeps out of the country itself, and information about cyber espionage actors is largely pieced together through vendor investigations from the likes of ourselves and our peers, and public reports compiled by governments or law enforcement agencies. And then other vendors have their own group names for North Korea activity, and they may have differing assessments on what constitutes a group. So I'll start at the top level. Hidden Cobra is a name that's used by the US government, and it is a catch-all designation to cover all North Korea-linked activity. Then Lazarus is the actor name that is probably most publicly linked to North Korea. It originally corresponded to a group that we call Appleworm, It originally corresponded to a group that we call Appleworm, but more frequently, recently, it's tended to be used as a catch-all name for all North Korea activity, and it's sort of been used interchangeably with Hidden Cobra. We ourselves have identified 7 distinct groups of activity that we would class as distinct groups linked to North Korea. So Stonefly is a group that Sylvester is going to talk about next, but of the remaining 6, Appleworm, who I mentioned earlier, who are also known as Lazarus, are probably the best known North Korean actor. And if you wanted me to speculate, they're probably the largest operation given the sheer range of attacks that they've been involved in. A lot of the activity I was speaking about is tied to Appleworm. That includes the Sony Pictures attack, the Bangladesh bank heist, WannaCry, the FastCash ATM attacks. And then most of the other actors that we've identified are a little bit more niche in terms of their area of operations. And the next one on the list is a good example of that. We call them Bloot. They've been around since 2009, and they used a backdoor called EgoBot in a number of attacks against South Korean targets. They appear to be really interested in executives who work for South Korean companies, or executives who work for companies who are doing business in South Korea. Ballworm then has a lot of links to Bloot because there's a lot of similarities between its code and the code in the EgoBot backdoor. However, while Bloot was engaged in really targeted attacks against identifiable individuals, Ballworm, its infection vector was hijacked software updates. So the attacks were pretty indiscriminate in nature, and it looks like they were just doing a wide-ranging trawl and see who they'd pick up, see if they'd find anybody interesting. Then Cloverworm, it is a more recent arrival on the scene. They showed up first in 2018. They've been pretty espionage focused, but they've also been linked to some financially motivated attacks against the cryptocurrency sector. Now, some vendors, most notably a Korean security firm called EST, considered them and Springtail as one in the same. However, we haven't seen enough links to kind of make that solid. So for the moment, we're regarding them as two distinct groups. Springtail itself is pretty narrowly focused on public sector organizations in South Korea. One of the main TTPs that this group is known for is that it uses exploits against the Hangul word processor, HWP. And Hangul is a commonly used word processor in South Korea, so not surprising given its area of activity. It has been mainly involved in espionage attacks, but they've been also involved in some disk wiping attacks, most notably, I think it was 2014, against the Korea Hydro and Nuclear Power Organization, and they used a wiper that's known as Destfallen. So while Springtail has been around for a good while now, its tactics don't appear to have changed too much, because we've seen evidence as recently as November, I think, of last year, of the continued use of HWP exploits. And then finally, Vidalia is known for using social engineering in the form of carefully constructed spear phishing emails to compromise the victims. It's one of the few North Korean groups we've seen using zero-day vulnerabilities in its attacks. And again, its focus appears to be pretty narrow, South Korea, and it specifically seemed to be interested in learning about South Korean policy towards North Korea. So that's the end of my part of the presentation. I'd like to turn you over now to Sylvester, who is going to talk to you about his research on the Stonefly group.
Great. Thanks, Dick. So we're going to shift our focus and look specifically at an actor called Stonefly. Stonefly is it's a perfect example of how focused North Korean groups can be, but also how their motives can sort of change over time. So in that sense, they can be unpredictable. Stonefly is very resourceful. They are hard to detect. And they're after some of the most valuable assets of their target organizations. So they're definitely a threat that should not be ignored. I am going to first talk about Stonefly's background and how their targeting has evolved over time. Then I'm going to take a detailed look at how they specifically operate. And then finally, I'm going to end on some recommendations with regards to Stonefly. Okay, so a little background on Stonefly. They first became present to the public in 2009. They came on the scene with a malware called Trojan.dozer. This was a disruptive malware. It carried out a DDoS attack. Symantec analyzed this in 2009 and found that it also, in addition to DDoS, it carried out wiping. So it wiped the master boot record of the machines that it was infecting. Jump to 2011, and Trojan.Corridos is sort of the same story. It is a DDoS malware that also carried out wiping. But in addition, on a subset of machines that were infected with that malware, Symantec discovered a relatively stealthy backdoor called Preoxer. Now, this was one of the first indications that Stonefly, in addition to carrying out disruptive activities, also was carrying out, or possibly was carrying out, espionage activity. And then finally in 2013 was sort of the most infamous attack of Stonefly. What Stonefly would be publicly attributed to was referred to as Dark Soul. So this is the name that you would most likely tie to Stonefly, is Dark Soul. And that malware was majorly disruptive. Trojan.Jokro wiped thousands of machines across hundreds of organizations in South Korea. At the same time, in 2013, evidence surfaced that Stonefly had been actually carrying out espionage activities going all the way back to 2009. So really, although Stonefly started out as being recognized for its disruptive, and destructive activities, it really has a history of both this espionage as well as the disruption. So where are they now? Stonefly has, in terms of geographic targeting, Stonefly has expanded in the past year. While they focused in the past on organizations in South Korea and the United States, they've expanded within Asia beyond just South Korea, although they're still primarily in Asia. But the real region that stands out is going to be the Middle East. 2019 and 2020 is the first year that we've seen Stonefly target organizations in that region. Now, in terms of the types of organizations that Stonefly is after, they seem to be targeting organizations that are involved in advanced research. And we really believe it's because they're motivated by cyber espionage. We have evidence that they're after specific types of information. Some examples are listed here: materials, energy, aerospace. We're not really sure what they're after when it comes to healthcare. But again, we believe that they're really after stealing really sensitive information, most likely industrial secrets. To give an example, we have evidence where Stonefly targeted a major global conglomerate, and the specific organization within that conglomerate that they targeted was conducting metallurgical research, specific research that had applications to energy, aerospace, and defense. And so we believe that Stonefly has a very focused agenda when it comes to the types of information that they're after. Okay, now I'm going to talk a little bit about how they operate. So when it comes to infection, Stonefly is relatively flexible. They're resourceful. They don't stick to one way of going about attacking their targets. We've seen in the past year at least three different infection vectors. The first being the web server exploit. We believe they use PHP to upload a web shell and then download a bunch of hacking tools onto the web server of the target organization. We've also seen spear phishing, which they utilize to download their custom backdoor, backdoor prefed. And then in 2020, we've seen Stonefly utilize an exploit against an IT administration software. Now, the interesting thing about this infection vector was how quickly they actually turned over this exploit. So it wasn't in any way a zero day. In fact, the exploit had been published 5 days earlier by a researcher who also published a proof of concept code. And it was actually patched a day later. But again, 4 days after the patch, we observed Stonefly using this to target an organization. They utilized this Java deserialization vulnerability and exploit against it to launch the built-in legitimate Bits admin tool, which then downloaded from a compromised website their custom backdoor prefed. So again, the turnaround time really shows how resourceful and flexible Stonefly can be. Now, post-compromise, Stonefly uses two types of tools primarily, and that's how they maintain stealth once they've compromised an organization. The first being what we refer to as living off the land tools. These are tools that are going to already be present on an environment of an organization, most likely used by IT administrators. For example, PSExec and WMI. Stonefly used these to probe, to discover network assets on an organization once they've compromised it, and also to move laterally. So to push their custom malware across machines within the organization, they use PSExec and sometimes WMI. They use tools like BitsAdmin. We can see here an example of Stonefly using BitsAdmin to download what looks like a JPEG, but really is a Mimikatz credential dumping hacking tool. The other type of tool that they use are dual-use tools. So these are tools that are legitimate. There's nothing inherently malicious about them, but they don't already exist on a target organization. They're introduced by Stonefly as part of their tool set. What we've seen in the past year in terms of dual-use tools for Stonefly is primarily communication tools. So PuTTY link SSH tunneling tool, a proxy tool, tools such as Netcat. So these are publicly available tools, but again, they're part of Stonefly's tool set. An example of how they use them is setting up an SSH tunnel on an infected machine and then tunneling their command and control communications through another machine that's infected within the organization, and then presumably out to the C2. We've discovered proxies that have been loaded by Stonefly onto public-facing web servers. Presumably, this is how they're getting out, communicating to their command and control servers. So again, they primarily rely on using these non-malicious tools once they've compromised an organization. When it comes to malware, Stonefly has access to a highly customized piece of malware that's relatively rare called backdoor Preft. And they really only use it in limited fashion. So when they need to maintain persistence, they'll install it as a service. And they're relatively careful in that they clean up afterward. They remove any trace that they've installed it. Now, this malware is often tailored to the specific target. We found samples of backdoor Preft that have had details of the target organization compiled into the actual malware. So again, it's highly tailored, it's custom, and it's used very sparingly. So what are they after? Well, we believe that Stonefly is, at the moment, a pure play espionage group. They're after highly sensitive industrial secrets, intellectual property. In one case, we've seen Stonefly use a Mimikatz credential dumping tool to steal credentials. And then shortly after that, we've seen a Postgres database tool being launched. And we suspect that stolen credentials were being used to an attempt to access sensitive information on the database. In another case, we've seen Stonefly collecting up sensitive files. I mentioned the metallurgical research as an example, and then archiving those files using WinRAR, and finally attempting to exfiltrate those files using a dual-use tool, a PuTTY SSH file copying tool called PuTTY SCP. Okay, now what are the implications of the Stonefly attack? There really are three. Firstly and foremost is that they're targeting very high value assets. These are advanced research, industrial secrets. This is intellectual property that is really key to these organizations. So the impact is definitely there. Secondly, they're relatively difficult to detect. They don't really rely on their custom malware. Instead, they use a lot of dual use and legitimate built-in tools. And then finally, their motivations are unpredictable in the sense that although they had a past of disruptive attacks, in hindsight, we know that they carried out both espionage and disruption concurrently. So although they appear to be a pure play espionage attack group at the moment, we can't really rule out that they'll carry out some sort of disruptive attack in the future. Now, as for recommendations, there are really two when it comes to Stonefly. The first is to focus on detection. Stonefly have lingered on organizations for up to a few months before they've actually moved on their objectives. So that's really the opportunity where they might be detected. Their initial compromise is really only a small piece of the attack chain. But the fact that they linger for a bit really is the opportunity to catch them on an organization before they're able to have any impact. And the second would be similar fashion to monitor for suspicious use of legitimate tools. So this includes both tools that are already present on an organization that are being abused in some way, but also to look for tools that are part of the Stonefly tool set that are not necessarily malicious, such as unexpected network and file transfer tools. Because they rely on these, that's the best bet to be able to find a Stonefly attack. So Stonefly is very resourceful, they're very flexible, they're highly focused, and they're after highly critical assets for their target organizations. So they're really not a group that should be ignored or overlooked in any way, shape, or form. And now I'm going to go ahead and hand over the deck to Javier. Take it away, Javier.
Thank you, Sylvester. So as we talked about Lazarus, Hidden Dragon, or Hidden Cobra, and Stonefly, we wanted to overlay the Symantec portfolio on top of the Acuren campaign. And each one of these divisions, the Symantec Enterprise Division of Broadcom, is focused on four different divisions: endpoint security, network security, information security, and identity security. Each one of these has a play in protecting the enterprise to these advanced actors and campaigns. For example, we mentioned the initial threat vector being email or watering hole attacks focused on potentially drive-by downloads, which can be stopped at the network side using our proxy capability integrated with our web isolation to ensure that uncategorized websites get redirected to an isolation chamber. Likewise, on the email or phishing campaigns, we can either analyze the attachments, block the attachments, or redirect them to another isolation chamber to make sure that these threats don't get into the environment and really blocking that initial threat vector. In terms of the motivations of espionage and stealing industrial secrets, the DLP application can do the categorization and classification of the data, making sure that it doesn't leave the enterprise if the rules say not to leave the enterprise. And also with the credential theft capabilities, the identity security has a play in there as well. But what I wanted to do is really focus and drill down into the endpoint security and show how the endpoint security applies its protection across the board. So Symantec has been focused heavily for the last year to really providing that single console, single management console, analytic console, and agent for the endpoint, give it or be it Windows, Mac, or Linux, or the modern OS's iOS, Android, or Windows. It's a complete end-to-end detection capability or protection capability with all these features from the traditional endpoint stack, which we'll talk about in a second, including attack surface reduction capabilities to really limit what the attackers have available to them in terms of compromising vulnerabilities or getting onto the endpoint to begin with. We have our EDR capability built into the same agent to bring visibility into what happens at the enterprise. We have a group of threat hunters that provide cloud analytics and can provide additional details on incidents back to the enterprises. And then our last line of defense, as Sylvester mentioned, is the adversaries are looking to steal the credentials and leverage credentials as they pivot or move laterally across the enterprise, is our threat defense for Active Directory, really looking at protecting the use of Active Directory in the enterprise and being able to detect on any malicious or suspicious attempted use of that those credentials. So as we look at the stack, we've overlaid the stack across the MITRE attack chain. MITRE attack chain, if you're not familiar, has 12 different tactics across the attack chain from ingress to egress, and covers about 270 plus techniques that the adversaries leverage as they compromise and do their activities on enterprises. So our capabilities of our endpoint solution are laid across the attack chain. On the pre-attack phase, we're looking at the app control and app isolation capabilities, breach assessment to really understand the environment, vulnerability remediation. One of the main capabilities we've been looking or working on is anything that is pre-attack or left of bang, if you will. If we can detect a threat pre-execution, then we have just saved the enterprise resources in terms of investigation, triage, and remediation. So ideally, the goal is to detect as early in the process as possible. So on the incursion side, all these capabilities are pre-execution. So if it's the traditional antivirus protection stack, or it's exploit mitigation techniques, or anything trying to use an exploit to exploit memory, if it's cloud reputation, or even our advanced machine learning, all this is pre-execution. On the infection side of the house, where we actually start the execution process, we have emulation engines that will emulate through both PE and non-PE files to make sure that the actions that are they're performing are not malicious in intent. And if they are, we'll block them before they get a chance to actually do anything on the system. But ideally on this infection stage is looking at the behaviors of the system itself and the applications running on the systems, and then providing that visibility back to the analyst if it gets to this stage. And then on the infestation side, we're really looking at the lateral movement, how we can make sure that whatever the adversary is trying to do on the network in terms of trying to move laterally, that we can prevent this. And then integrating with our DLP and our egress capabilities is looking and making sure that there's no content leaving the enterprise. And all this, all these capabilities, again, all, with that single agent, the single management console, leveraging on the back end, our global intelligence network. And so as we look at the MITRE ATT&CK framework and how this overlays with the Lazarus group, the Lazarus group leverages about 80 different techniques of the MITRE ATT&CK framework across the breadth of the 12 tactics from initial access. These two initial access points are the drive-by download or the watering hole attack and spear phishing. And then it goes through the execution persistence across the board. So it's a very, as Sylvester mentioned, sophisticated group that leverages a lot of different capabilities across the board, focused on live off the land and dual use tools. And so as we overlay this with our protection capabilities and detection capabilities of the Symantec Endpoint Complete product, we see how we can protect the enterprise. Protect in regards to blocking activities from happening, or detect in regards to bringing that visibility and detecting the use of those dual use tools, and even potentially limiting what they're capable of doing on the network or on the endpoint. And this, starting from the left here, the initial access, this is actually a drive-by download. And since I don't have any of the network capabilities deployed in this overlay, you'll see that there is, because it's a user-initiated action, potential for drive-by download if you're only looking at the endpoint protection product to be successful. But then when you, once that file or once that hits the endpoint, then the rest of the protection stack will take effect. And the idea here is really looking across the board. You know, as you look at the enterprise and its security capabilities, it's not enough just to deploy one technology. It's really an end-to-end solution that needs to be managed across the enterprise to make sure that all threat vectors are blocked. And if there's still some way of getting into the enterprise, that you have layered defense all the way through the enterprise and into the endpoint. For more information on the Symantec Endpoint Security Complete, we actually have another webinar on the 26th that will go into detail of each one of the components of the capability. So I would encourage everybody to tune in there as well. And with that, Dick, I'm going to turn it back over to you if there's any questions or if we want to close this out.
Okay, sorry, I almost forgot to unmute myself. Thanks very much, Javier. Yeah, we have some time for to take some questions. We've already got some questions in, but if you would like to ask a question, by all means, post it up there, and we'll do our best to answer as many as possible. If there are questions that we can't answer, we'll endeavor to get back to you with something if we can. The first question I see here is actually, it might just be a kind of really a request for clarification. It's they're asking, are Stonefly actually targeting China? And I think the reason they were asking that is that we were kind of breaking out the attacks by region. So we were highlighting all of Asia, including China. We aren't actually saying that China was attacked. We were just saying the targets were in Asia. The second question is a pretty interesting one. Which group, North Korean group, do we think is the most advanced? I don't know, Sylvester, do you have any opinions on that?
You know, advances, it's really hard to put a measure on what's advanced. I think what makes a lot of these North Korean groups stand out is it's really how they can evolve over time. If you take Appleworm as an example, it's a really steep learning curve to be able to build malware that understands how the backend systems on a financial institution works, given how convoluted they might be. Malware that's able to actually intercept ATM related format messages, that's definitely a leap from, you know, just DDoSing or something of that nature. So really their ability to sort of ramp up their technical abilities, I think, is what makes these North Korean groups stand out.
Yeah. I mean, it's something that struck me as well. Like, while some groups like Stonefly, they're capable of penetrating organizations with really valuable IP, just the sheer range of Appleworm attacks, the range of capabilities, and the fact that they're able to educate themselves so much on the internal systems and banks and know how they work and know how payment systems work and know what to target is pretty advanced. We've got another question in, and it's to do with, I guess, the foreign currency requirements of the regime. And they say, I think there are different reasons why North Korea operates worldwide cyber attacks. Have you seen any trend where North Korea got more aggressive to bring in more cash to the North Korean regime after the implementation of international sanctions, or as well after, say, COVID-19 broke out to help its damaged economy? Can you give any specific examples of that? And I think, in my opinion anyway, it's probably difficult to track financial attacks to such a level of granularity. I think at this stage, there's just an ongoing requirement for foreign currency, and probably the instruction is get as much as you can. I don't think we can map attacks directly to political developments like that. I think there's probably some examples where we may see possible increased pressure on attackers. I think the WannaCry ransomware attack seems to be quite rushed. They made a lot of mistakes, so maybe they were under pressure to initiate it. And when you contrast that with, say, how well planned the Bangladesh bank attack was, maybe they were under pressure at that particular time. So keep the questions coming. I got another question in saying that we're talking that Springtail, we're still using HWP exploits up until last year. What kind of organizations were being targeted? That's quite a tough question, and I'll tell you why. Because we didn't actually see the attacks directly ourselves. We found what amounts to indirect evidence of attacks. So what happened was, earlier on this year, the US government released IOCs for a bunch of North Korean tools, one of which was a rat called Copper Hedge. So naturally, we ran them through our own systems to see if we had any hits, and we found a few web servers in South Korea that had those IOCs present. And anyway, it turned out that they belonged to this online PDF conversion service, which also had lots of hits from malicious HWP files containing exploits. So we don't think that service itself was the target. Rather, what we suspect happened is that victims were getting these malicious HWP files in their emails, probably, and then uploading them to this service. And I think it's possibly that they couldn't read the file, didn't realize it was malicious, and maybe they thought they could make it readable by converting it to a PDF. So that's why we think that these attacks have continued. Now, any more questions before we wrap it up? Okay, I think that's going to be it. Thank you very much, Sylvester. Thank you, Javier, for joining us today. Thank you for your time. And remember, you can always access a recording of this presentation by clicking on the same link you used to join. Okay, thank you very much, and goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.